I want to speak about revelation. About revelation. The gospel, Paul says in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, that famous verse that he's not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power unto salvation, right? And he says first to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. He says, for why in verse 17? For in this gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed. The gospel has revelation. And he says, from faith to faith, for as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. But this gospel is not just information. It is revelation. And the title of the message is that every generation needs revelation. Every generation needs revelation. And it's a thing that has largely in the church, we have been blessed by the Lord. But there is something here that we can grow in. But largely in the West, what we have made Christianity to be is intellectual pursuit. Maybe we can, if we learn a lot about Jesus, if we learn a lot about the Bible, that is going to mean growth. That is going to mean that you know, we're somehow progressing in our Christianity. And we've spoken about this a lot in the church, that not so with the Christian life. Every other religion has moral principles, teaches moral values, has a value system, and they gather also on some day, will be a Friday, will be a Saturday, Sunday, whatever day it is, they gather, and they have someone who would teach what they consider to be wisdom and wise, and they train people to behave in a certain way. And that's not Christianity. Christianity, we don't train people. We don't make bad people good people. That's not Christianity. And this is fundamental, where we need to know that when Jesus came and the revelation he brought was to challenge this very idea that Christianity is somehow something we can obtain and learn, and it's sort of a washing of just all the dust off. But you have the same product. It's just a bit cleaner. The Bible, the New Covenant, is a covenant of new beginning, of new life, of new creation. Brother Ben spoke about the need for being born again, something entirely new. And it is the power of God, not the power of man. Man cannot have control over this. When Jesus spoke to Nicodemus, he said to Nicodemus, you must be born again. If you want to see the kingdom of God, if you want to enter the kingdom of God, you must be born of the Spirit and of water. What is born of flesh is flesh. And then he says to Nicodemus, look at the wind. You don't know where it goes or how it works, but you can see its effects. And he was saying to this Pharisee, to this man of the establishment, this man of religion, that Nicodemus, this life does not belong to a system. Man has no control over the wind. You don't know when and how it goes. Who does? Who knows how the wind works? Who sends forth the wind? Is it not the Lord? And he says, this new life works like that. You can see its power. You can feel the wind. You can see it move in the trees. But you cannot control it. It's not something of the flesh, Nicodemus. It's not something of your physical circumcision. It's not something to do with somehow your pedigree or the tribe you've born in or the education you have. It has got to do with something that God has to do. It is in His hand. It is in His control. And the gospel that Jesus came to bring is that very thing, that in it, God does something. God reveals His righteousness. God reveals who He is in the gospel. And that is what is supposed to change people. People can go their whole life through a religious system, through a church system, and not know God. Not have an encounter with Him. Not have had this revelation of the righteousness of God. And that's what we want to avoid. Because what I want to focus on, even though I know many of you know this, I know that many of you understand that to come to Christ, to come to the Lord, you have to have an encounter with Him. And I know that many of you know this, but what one thing that we often forget is that this is not just how we start. This is how we grow. This is how we move forward in the Christian life. The Christian life is not just an encounter with God in the beginning, but it is revelation on revelation on revelation on revelation. That is what sustains us. That's what makes us grow. And that's why Paul says when he discusses the nature of the new covenant and the book of Corinthians, we focused a lot on this in the last couple of months in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and 2 Corinthians chapter 4. He starts to talk about the nature of his ministry. What sets his ministry apart from those who were exalting in the works of the law and the righteousness that they established by themselves. And he says, look, my ministry is not the ministry of the letter. The ministry that God has given me, even though I'm not adequate, even though I can contribute nothing to it, even though the very ministry I have is a gift and He has, by His power, made me adequate to minister this. But it's the ministry of the Spirit. It is a Spirit ministry. It's not the ministry of the letter. Bibles alone, just having words on ink, is not going to change us. The Holy Spirit has to come and open the Word up to us and then apply it to us and change us into His likeness. And that's what we call revelation. You see, I've said this before, that in Amos chapter 8, God makes it very clear that in the last days He's going to send a famine on the land. And He says this will not be a famine for food and water and food and drink, but it will be a famine for the Word of God. Now, that does not mean in the last days that there won't be Bibles. That does not mean that there is not going to be a lot of information. On my computer, I say, with my logo software and everything I have more access to information, background commentaries, exegetical commentaries, all the things you could think of in terms of information. The West is filled with information. But what's dying out, what the judgment that's coming, the thing that the Lord is withdrawing, is revelation. The Word that's alive, the Word that brings life, is going to become more and more rare. A famine on the land. A famine. And what does famine do? Famine starves us. We our bodies need food to stay strong. Right? To grow, to stay healthy. And therefore revelation is the same thing. If we don't live a life of revelation, the Christian life comes to a halt. It becomes sick, becomes unhealthy. And so I want to just encourage us this morning to seek revelation. To seek revelation. We serve a God who's alive and who speaks and who wants to have fellowship with us. I agree with Brother Ben that, but Bible reading, prayer, fellowship are not the end of all things. They are means of how we meet with God. And if you look at Jesus' life and in his 3 years, I don't think he had much time in those 3 years to sit for hours and read the scriptures. You looked at his days, look how busy Jesus was. He was extremely busy. But he had constant fellowship with God. He was one with the Father. He was abiding in the Father through the Holy Spirit, you see. And though he had so much, and you can see before even the sun rose, you know, he was going over here and over there, and people were coming to him over and over all the place. He was abiding. He was abiding in the life-giving spirit of his Father. That's so important, brothers and sisters. We don't, a lot of people have Bibles. A lot of people are gathering right this moment in church. But it's absent. The life of Jesus is absent. There's no life. There's no revelation. We don't look at these things as the end. Jesus himself said to the Pharisees, "You search the scriptures because in it you think there's life. But the scriptures point to me, and you should come to me to have life." God is not contained in ink. This is where we can have either this word can administer death to us, the letter can kill. But when we healed and we recognize that this scriptures is pointing to us to have a relationship with the Almighty God, then these words will become alive. Then the Lord will start to reveal himself to us. And Jesus himself said to his disciples, he said, "I am the vine. I am the vine, you are the branches. I'm the true vine. You can't abide in anything else. You have to abide in me." And then this life from this vine flows into the branches. What is this life? It's very easy for us to say, right? The life is the life of Jesus. The very life in him we have, if we abide in him. But practically, what is this? What is this life? We've looked at this verse also a lot. I want to focus on a lot of things we've spoken about in the last 2 months so that we can be rooted in these things, because this is the core of the Christian life. 2 Peter 1 verse 3 says, "God has given us all things pertaining to life and godliness." How? "Through the knowledge of him who has called us to his own glory and excellence." So it's in knowing God that we get life. We are sustained. This is where God's given us all things pertaining to life, and God-like character is through this knowing him. Now, God is spirit. How do we know him? Through revelation. Through revelation, through himself, revealing himself to us daily. That's the manna that we talk about. That is the food. That's what means to feed upon Christ. It's not simply a devotional. Reading a devotional, it's not simply reading, memorizing a scripture verse. It's not just simply saying a prayer. It is having an encounter with the living God. That's what Christianity is. That's what they proclaimed. We know him who is alive. He is alive and we have a relationship with him. He talks to us. He directs us. He leads us for this life. Not just for the next life, for this life. God is with us. His presence is with us. He dwells with us. God is not mute. God is not silent. Whenever that happens, that is a judgment. That's when the vision perishes, as it says in Proverbs. The people perishes when there's no vision, when there's no revelation, when people are this is where blindness is. When there's none of that, then people perish. The spirit can only live by this revelation. That's how the Christian life is sustained and grown. That's how we're going to grow. To abide in this vine, to have this life through knowing Christ, that he's alive. Jesus asked this question to his disciples, and he first asked, and he says to them in Matthew chapter 16, he says to them, "Who do you say I am? Who am I?" And then they answer, all of them answer, like, you know, some say you're Elijah, some say you're Jeremiah, some say you're a prophet. And then he specifically asks again, and he says, "But who do you say I am? Who do you say?" And then Peter answers him, and he says, "You are the Son of the living God. You are the Christ. You are the Son of the living God. And then Jesus looks at Peter and he says to Peter that flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father in heaven revealed this to you. And then he says to Peter that on this I will build my church. This is the revelation that we need to have, the same thing as Peter. Many people know Jesus. They can know in terms of information who Jesus claimed to be. Yeah, I've read that Jesus is the Son of God. I've read that Jesus came and he did this. And I've, yes, and anybody can read that. Anybody can go and look at history and see that history testifies not only to his death, not only to his burial, but to his resurrection. Resurrection is so well testified in history. Best explanation for the empty tomb. And we can know these things, but Jesus has said there's something different that happened to Peter here. Peter had a revelation. Something was revealed to Peter's heart that Jesus is not merely a man. He's not just an important figure. He's not just babbling what Jesus has told him. He's received something from God. And that's what we all must have. That's how Jesus will build his church. That's what we all must have. You know, we have such a privilege in the new covenant. I cannot stress this enough. That in the Old Testament, it was prophets, it was kings, it was priests who received revelation, who received God revealing himself in a mighty and powerful way. But when the new covenant comes, the veil is torn. It's now all will know me from the least to the greatest. Hallelujah. We all can come through Christ and look at the glory of God. We all can have revelation. We are not to go to a certain place on earth or to a certain man. God invites all of us afresh today. Come to me and know me. Come to me and know me. I have made a way for all of you. From the least to the greatest. I've torn the veil. Come and look. Come and see. Come and see who I am. That's his invitation this morning again. That's Christianity, to know God. Do you know him like this? If this is dying in you, I pray that the Lord will bring us through faith and repentance this morning. I want you to know that God desires to have this relationship with you. Christianity is supernatural. Christianity is filled with the supernatural and the power of God. The way he changes us is not got to do with clever methods of men or training. He transforms us. He makes us new. That's what we need to trust. And that's what we need to trust for our children. Lord, please, my children don't need a lot of more teachings. Lord, they need revelation. They need what I had. They need to see you, Lord. Please, open their eyes. You are the Savior. Please, Lord. And I know that this is a burden for many of us, maybe family members. Lord, please. I have spoken and spoken and spoken and spoken and spoken. But Lord, I yield to you this morning. I need you to tear down this veil, this blindness, Lord. Show them who you are. And see, that's why the body of Christ is so important, brothers and sisters. Because when we come together and there's unity and we pull together, the glory of God descends. And when people enter here, they experience God. They have a revelation of his mercy and his grace and his goodness. And then there's a real encounter that changes people. It's not sermons, it's his presence. That's what changes people. And that's what we should have as a church. That's our goal. Lord, build us together. Why build us together? Because we are your temple. And that's where you must dwell. When we meet together, you should be the center, Lord. If you don't reveal yourself, we are in a famine. and we're going to slowly die. We need you, Lord. We feed upon Jesus. If it's not that, there is no Christianity. Anything else doesn't matter. It just doesn't matter. It has to be that we live in a life and a body where God is continually revealing himself. That's Christianity. That's how we grow. That's how we stay alive. That's the lampstand. I show myself. And that's what I need this morning. And that's what you need this morning. We need the Lord to reveal himself in a fresh way. Hallelujah. I just want to focus on some things, some characteristics that is so important when we talk about Revelation. You know, this word was confirmed by Sister Claudia when she prayed, and I praise God for that. Before I mention the characters, and I'll go to a famous passage of Scripture in the book of Isaiah chapter 6. But just, I want to stress this principle before I do, that is in play now, that applies to us now, is that from the beginning in the Torah, in the wisdom literature, you know, the Proverbs, in the prophets, Jeremiah, in the Gospels, through Jesus, it emphasizes over and over again that those who seek will find. Those who seek with all of their hearts, I will reveal myself to them. These are the ones I reveal myself to. Those who not seek with actions, who don't do. There's a lot of people that do. There's a lot more than us that are so devoted to just an outward religion. God is not interested in that. God's looking for what is the heart directed towards. Is the heart that the true self directed to know me? Or seeking an answer from me, or appealing or calling out to me. That's what God is saying. Is there such a heart? And to that heart, I will reveal myself. I said before that in Revelation chapter 1, verse 7, Jesus emphasizes the fact that when he comes again, every eye shall see him. Every eye shall see him when he comes. Every eye. In other words, that there's something different about this time and now. Now, everybody does not see Jesus now. In fact, when you look at Jesus' ministry, he started, you know, speaking quite openly about the kingdom in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5 to 7. And then he started through the parables. As he saw people were following him for the wrong reasons, he started to teach them parables and hide meaning. He said, if you really want to seek, you have to be a seeker to actually get to the truth now. And Jesus was more and more withdrawing himself. And now when he died and he rose again, when he got out of the grave, he did not show himself. He showed himself to only 500 people. The rest, he did not show himself. You see, God, Jesus is not it now. He's not someone who runs after everybody and gives them evidence and shows him and reveals himself. No. No, no, no. God is looking for those who's looking for him. God is looking for seekers. And the worst thing that you can have is that your first revelation of Christ is when he comes on that cloud. Every eye will see him. Everybody will eyes. I will see him in his glory. Every eye will see him high and lifted up and with all authority and power coming to both judge the living and the dead. Every eye will see him, but I will be too late. Now God is saying, those who seek me, I will reveal myself to them. We see how Daniel in chapter 9, verse 3, it was a difficult time. They were in Babylon. And he wants to seek the Lord. It says he seek the Lord through prayer, through fasting, through sackcloth and ashes. He was seeking the Lord for a word of his time and day. He was seeking the Lord. He wanted to have revelation for his people and for his days. He said, Lord, what? And he started to confess his sins and the sins of his people. And that's he said he set his heart to Jerusalem. He was seeking the Lord. And I've mentioned this before, and just a chapter later, Daniel chapter 10, verse 12, the angel appears and tells him, since you set your heart to seek the Lord, I have determined to come to you. God answers those who seek him. God, those who persevere, those who endure, those who say, Lord, I will not let go. I need to meet with you. I cannot go further without you meeting with me, Lord. Please. You are salvation. Salvation is not a doctrine that we, ascribe to. It's a person. He is. It is him. And that's what we need to realize this morning. This whole message will mean nothing if we don't stir ourselves. The Bible says that some of these men stirred themselves. Say, wake up. I need the Lord. I need to stir myself because this world is constantly making me sleepy. And the Holy Spirit is saying, wake up. Wake up. Seek the Lord. The veil has been torn. Christ can be seen. The good news has come. God can be known. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Isn't that good news? Or has it become old news? For many people, the good news is old news. They can't get excited about it. Why? Because they don't have revelation on it. It's old. I know that. I pray that God can revive this in us and renew it. It must be good news, always. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. So, I want to focus just, I'll see how much I will say still more, but I want to highlight something about Revelation, about the true characters of Revelation. And you see, Revelation is a magnifier. It enlarges, it magnifies what we can't see, it magnifies what we're blind to, it magnifies what we seem to that's far away, it's brought near. It zooms in. It unveils, it magnifies. And here again, Isaiah has this encounter. And many times the Bible, it records to us when a person had this life-changing encounter with God. And I know this chapter has, you've probably heard many messages on it. But I want to highlight some things here that's so important. And I believe the Holy Spirit really wants me to, especially in light of what Sister Claudia prayed. The first thing and the most important thing, the foundation. We read in verse 1 in Isaiah chapter 6 that Isaiah, he saw the Lord, and it was in the reign of in the time when King Uzziah died. In other words, it's political unrest, it's uncertainty, it's difficult times. And it's in this time that God reveals himself, where he takes Isaiah and he brings him into his presence. Now here's what is important for me, and I cannot stress this enough, from verses 1 to 4, Isaiah gets to see the Lord. Yes, he describes the angels. He describes the angels' worship or behavior towards the one who sits upon the throne. But the whole focus is on the holiness of God. The whole focus is on how exalted, how lifted up the Lord is. And here is where I cannot emphasize this enough. That revelation at its foundation, at its core, is always God-centered, Christ-centered. Revelation always brings you back to God being exalted, to Christ being exalted. When other things are exalted in your life, when you get distracted over and over again by different things, it's because God is not exalted. So I said this before, so many people, they can get excited about other things. They can get excited about churches and preachers. They get excited about theology, but they're not excited about Jesus. You see, when people encountered the Lord, there was nothing else in their heart or in their lips. They saw the Lord. The Lord is magnified in your life. The Lord becomes the center in your life. And that's what my prayer is, that God will get magnified in our families. God will get magnified in this church and in our lives. That we get excited about Jesus again and about the good news. You see, this is the center of it. It's not merely what was going to happen after this. This is all the fruit of God becoming the center. When Christ is lifted up, when God is exalted, the rest of it will take, it will be a natural fruit. It will take care of itself. But what Revelation does, and what is so important, is that it puts the Lord where He belongs. We in our flesh cannot do that. We cannot do that, brothers and sisters. What we understand is still so little. What we know to be true is still so little. Revelation is God saying, this is actually who I am. You thought I was holy. You had a concept of it. Let me show you. You thought my mercy was great. Let me show you. You thought my grace is sufficient. Let me show you. And that teaching can't do that. Preaching can't do that, brothers and sisters. It has to be revelation. It has to be the Holy Spirit that opens this to us. If He does not open this to us, we remain in blindness. But that's the good, precious, wonderful privilege of the new covenant. I have made a way. I have torn the veil. I am now reachable. I'm near. You don't have to be blind anymore. I can now reveal myself to you and put myself in your life where I belong. And in the church, other things can easily rise up. And the big problem is that many of us, we have information that God is big. We have information that He's all powerful. We have information that He has made certain promises to us. But we haven't had revelation on these things. To know, to see. You see, you think Isaiah, whatever he was, we're not sure. Maybe a priest, we're not sure. But you think Isaiah, as a man of God, as a religious Jew of that time, did not know that God is holy. He had a better idea than me and you, I tell you. But when he saw the Lord, whatever he could possibly thought and whatever he's heard, it's never like he experienced before. That's the difference, brothers and sisters. Praise God that we can hear the word. But I pray that God, that you would become jealous. Become jealous. Because what Isaiah had in the new covenant, we can all have. Come and see the Lord. Don't trust what other people say. Come and see for yourself. Come and know Jesus for yourself. Don't stay at a distance. Follow Him closely. Come and touch yourself to Him. And it's when He's placed in this position, it's when the Lord says, this is who I am. This is how exalted and how high I am. Then suddenly things become very, very real for Isaiah. And of course, the first thing he realizes is all his unworthiness to stand before God. You know, Sister Claudia mentioned, Lord, we need to see our sins. Lord, we need to see our sins. And it's in light when God puts himself where he belongs. And he's so exalted, and you see other holy beings that are without sin. Cherubim cannot look upon him. They're covering their face. It's in light of that that Isaiah starts to realize, I am ruined, I am undone. Not just the fact that I have unclean lips. Not just the fact that I am dwelling amongst the people of unclean lips. But then with my unclean lips, with my uncleanness, I've looked at him. I've looked at his precious, holy, without stain, his character, his glory. I've looked at it. I'm undone. I deserve to die. Can you see how sin gets magnified? Isn't that something small to us? It's hard for us even to read that and understand. What? Something so small. But if you spoke to Isaiah, he will say to you, I felt like dying when I stood there. You don't understand the conviction I had. You don't understand how I felt when I saw the Lord. And I looked at all these holy beings. And I looked at him. That's when sin gets placed in its rightful place, brothers and sisters. And we don't trifle with it. And we realize how much we need the Lord. And in light of this, God shows Isaiah, magnifies not just himself, not just Isaiah's unworthiness, his sinfulness, but his mercy. His mercy. The angel goes and takes tongs. It's what the priests use as well. And goes with where the altar is, where they burn the sacrifices, and takes one of the coals and brings it to Isaiah's lips. And I've mentioned this to a couple of brothers and sisters before. I'm amazed that the angel is not allowed to touch this coal. He takes tongs. This holy being takes tongs. And he uses the tongs. He doesn't touch this coal. This coal is not for him. But it's allowed to touch the lips of Isaiah. How awesome is that? That the very blood of Jesus, this pure, precious blood that was spilled for us, it's not for the angels. It's nowhere for no one else. But that precious, pure sacrifice of Christ can come to my dirtiness, my filth, and wash it and clean it and touch it and wash it away. Isn't that good news this morning? Praise the Lord. Brothers, Ben said, Lord, we want revelation of the blood. Of the blood, the power, the goodness of it. And I tell you, brothers and sisters, this to me, every time I read it, I think, Lord, how is this possible? How is it possible that you have such mercy, Lord? That your precious blood comes to my stains and touches it and washes away. And I didn't deserve it. I didn't have to do anything for it, Lord. I just have to trust you. And you came and you washed me. And you see, when people are touched like that, this is all that revelation does. I pray that the blood of Jesus doesn't get old. That the forgiveness that God has given us does not get old. Rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord this morning. Praise him for his sacrifice. Praise him for his mercy. Praise him that Jesus went to the cross for us and he did not spare anything. He poured out his life on that cross. So that if you have sinned this morning, you can come with confidence to him and be washed. Hallelujah. You can go out clean today. Praise the Lord. You see, Revelation takes truths we know, brothers and sisters, and magnifies them. The last thing I'll mention is it took Revelation for Isaiah to hear God's actual concern and burden and plan and purpose for the generation of Isaiah. It is only after he was touched by God's mercy, it was only after where he realized that he himself needed a Savior, he himself is needed of God's grace and God's goodness and God's mercy. It's only after that he starts hearing the Lord saying, "Who shall we send? Who shall we send?" You see, my prayer is, brothers and sisters, as Brother Ben was showing to us and what the Lord has done, where there's revelation in your life, where you're living, this is a reality for you, where the church is living in revelation. We can therefore be absolutely confident that God will, in fact, give us the words that we need and the purpose and the plan and the ministry we need to reach this generation. God did not give Isaiah at that time things that he must speak to following generations. He said, "No, look, I'm going to send you for this people. And this is my word." No longer does churches have to trust in programs and plans and come together, have a committee and say, how are we going to do this? What is the plan? When there's revelation, you can start seeing Jesus, where he's going and following him. He will lead you and guide you. Revelation means that we can reach others. We know the heart of God for others. We are not blind to it. But we are aware. We have a relevant, and I not mean as the world says relevant, but a word in season for people. Isaiah's ministry was not a nice one. He was going to have to preach judgment. But God's message always was that was through, come and turn. Say, I want to save you. And I believe that when revelation is burning in the church and in our lives, we will hear the Lord. We will hear the Lord and we will respond to him and he will give us words and ministries that will speak and touch people around us. That's what revelation. Revelation is needed for service. You want to serve? Come to know the Lord. You know, I really want this to be a word that is more than just a nice Sunday. This is your Christian walk. It is from a revelation to a revelation. It's just, and Paul would put it differently because he looked at it from our perspective, it's from faith to faith. God reveals himself to those who seek him, to those who's looking for him. We have an enormously, wonderfully, I just don't have all the adjectives at the moment, but words fail me. The new covenant is extraordinary. What we have access to is amazing, brothers and sisters. To know the creator of the heavens and earth. And if we don't live in revelation, he becomes very small in our lives. Information, man, everybody, if we speak to anybody here this morning, God is big, God is this, God is that. Is that how your week look this week? Do you live in light of God being magnified? That's what God has for us, to walk in the light as He is in the light. That means we see God for who He is. Isn't that awesome? Praise the Lord. I want us to have a time of prayer. I don't want to speak more. I believe that you understand the message. You understand the privilege. God inviting us again. Come and know me. Know me. I will show myself to you. Maybe if we can even pray for one another, maybe groups of two or three, just have a time of prayer, you know, and say, Lord, this is Christianity. This is the simplicity in Christ. Don't get distracted from this. If this is not right, nothing else in the Christian life is going to function. This has to be there. So meet maybe with two or three. We'll have a time of prayer, and then I invite Brother Levi to come and finish, close the meeting. Praise the Lord.